that's what printmakers have always done, and artists have always done, is to try to take new technology and explore what that new technology allows them to do. Hey, Grenicia.
So thanks for doing hashtag Ava Pop-Up. We really appreciate you trying this out with us.
Sure. Thank you. I'm just glad to be a part of this.
So we have two of your pieces in the back. So tell us about your career and how you got started in the arts.
It goes way back. I mean, creating art is just something that I've always done. It's just something I remember always doing from when I was little. Went to University of Tennessee, Chattanooga. Graduated there in 1984 with a graphic design major. At that time, I was working for a local grocery store chain, and they had an advertising department. So basically what I did was do the old style cut and paste, the ads for newspaper, grocery store ads. And really learned a lot by doing something that simple.
Yeah.
I learned a lot about process and how even something that simple was done.
Mm-hmm.
I retired 3 years ago from the city of Chattanooga, but for 30 years I worked for the regional planning agency and did a number of things there, but I started there in the graphics department and did that for about 10 to 12 years.
Mm-hmm.
Became a neighborhood land use planner. Then the last 10 years that I was there, I was a director of subdivision and zoning. That doesn't sound very artistic, but fortunately I was able to use my abilities, my artistic abilities. I was able to bring a creative approach to whatever projects that we worked on.
Right. Your graphic design background, does that play into your printmaking that you're doing now?
It does. I went to UTC and learned a lot there, but I've always found that you absorb more and learn more by doing. And so by working in graphic design and trying to solve problems for other people, you really learn a lot of different insights and a lot of different techniques.
Mm-hmm.
I remember years ago when I first watched an offset printing machine work. Thought that was amazing. You feed paper in, you feed these plates in, you mix up all this ink, and it spits out images and letters and words. But what was kind of caught my attention more than the final output was all the ink piled up on the edges of the rollers, the edges of the paper. And I just thought that was so cool.
Yeah.
There's a lot of good imagery on the edge of the paper that was thrown away. So I noticed some of that coming into my recent work, where I've been working, experimenting with some abstract pieces. So my recent work really came from a desire to simplify my process, to simplify my studio, simplify materials and tools, and to try to create a process at the same time that was unique to me and that would allow me a little bit of a freedom. My mantra, I guess, is that most artists, if not all artists, create from a place of inspiration, influence, and experimentation.
Mm-hmm.
So all through history, there have been different technologies, technology changes. And as it changed, artists would try to take advantage of that new technology. Most of my career, I've worked more traditional, doing detailed watercolors, detailed. I tried to really explore or even exploit the opportunities that a computer could give. So printmaking, what I was trying to do here is take traditional methods that you would use to make marks, either with paint or ink. I use paint, digitize those marks, whether they're broad areas of black paint or pencil line or mark line, some sort of dark black mark.
Mm-hmm.
That in itself started fulfilling a need that I had to simplify my process, simplify my tools, and even the color, just a simple black. So how would I convert that black into the opportunities of all the colors available on a computer? So by digitizing the black in a drawing program, I'm able to manipulate, stretch, move those shapes. Then I can go through the colors, I can apply colors, layers, I can get transparent layers until it looks like a print on my screen. I noticed that if I didn't line these layers up perfectly, then you had these little edges that overlapped and it looked accidental and it looked not perfectly created like by a computer. So that kind of interested me in playing with that more. Quick studio tour. It's pretty small, so it won't take long. I have a couple of drawing tables and like this over there. I have one that I do some messy work on, painting. Then it's a cool little drawing table. I also do some work on. This is usually what I'll do. I use like a scraper, putty knife, and black paint, and I end up with something like this. And then I digitize that, take it over here, and I work on my computer. And that's pretty much it. This is just a view of my studio. I have some of my work on the walls.
Yeah. It's very nice and clean.
Yes. That is one thing. Before I start anything, I like to have it nice and neat and clean. That's just important for me to have a clean space. So,
yeah. Is that a kid's easel in there too?
It is. This is my 2-year-old granddaughter's spot. So if I'm back here working, she gets to come back here and work too. So recent work. Mm-hmm. I wanted to create something that looked like it was handmade and that it maybe have been produced on a traditional printing press. So I was trying to merge the printing process and printmaking with the digital world and make use of current technology.
Right. With your titles and your colors, do they have a relationship? You start off with black and then you see colors on the computer and you're like, yeah, they'll look good together. And then after you create the piece, then you find a title for it.
In an effort to simplify, then I try to identify a process that works, mm-hmm. Or at least makes intuitively feels like it works. So I'll start looking at families of color, and I just kind of scroll through families of color until I see something that just strikes me.
Yeah.
To me, it's really no different. When I do botanical paintings, that starts with a walk in the woods. So I walk through the woods, I look for something that catches my eye. Mm-hmm. So the tools that I use really are available to anyone. I simply use a Google drawing program. So if you have a Google account, mm-hmm. you have access to all sorts of products. So all I do is I use a Google drawing program as my layout board. Huh. And then I pile everything on that. Get back to the color. I just connect with colors that kind of resonate with me. And then I kind of start playing around with the design, the composition, play with the colors until I arrive at something that's pleasing. Titles are somewhat random, but as far as my process for selecting the title, I like to read a lot. And one of the most succinct, simple forms of poetry is haiku. So I have a haiku book, I'll kind of scan through there, I'll read through. I might come across a phrase or a word, and I look at that, look at the piece I've just finished, and see if there's any kind of emotional or intuitive connection between a phrase and the final piece. If there's a connection, then that's where the title comes from.
Yeah.
To me, there's kind of a similar process when somebody writes haiku. There are rules, but it's kind of an abstract form of writing.
And because it has the rules of how many words can be in each line, it kind of has the minimalism aspect too.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I never looked at your work as a haiku. That makes sense. Well, sure. I appreciate your time.
Sure, thank you very much.
Sharing this is, info and sharing your work.
Yeah, it's been helpful to try to talk through and explain. That's the hard part. Yeah. Creating is hard enough.
I find that about artists. Yeah, this was great.
Sure, thank you very much.
Yeah.